Well, good morning. I'm Herb Warden. I'm one of the pastors here at Cooper City Church of God. Let me start by saying Happy Father's Day to all of you that are watching us online. Now, as fathers, we're often accused of telling a certain type of joke. It's not necessarily a good joke. It's not necessarily a bad joke. It's what's referred to as a dad joke. But today, gentlemen, I say today, gentlemen, everyone who loves fathers must laugh at our dad jokes. So here's a test to see how much our family members and our friends love us dads. How would they respond to dad jokes? Here goes. Who is the smallest person in the Bible? Well, of course, it's Nehemiah. Okay. Who is the most business savvy woman in the Bible? Well, everybody knows that it's Pharaoh's daughter. She went to the bank of the Nile and she pulled out a little profit. And finally, what kind of person was Boaz before he got married? Well, that man was ruthless. He was ruthless. Well, thank you to everyone who laughed online at those dad jokes today. I encourage all of our fathers to unveil your full arsenal of dad jokes on your entire family. And remember, they are obligated to laugh at every single one of them. Speaking of jokes, I can remember the first sermon assignment I had at Cooper City Church of God. It was part of the Cooper City Church of God's men's ministry, Shout Out to the Disciples of Christ. I thought I'd stir things up a little bit, so I wore a multicolored clown wig, and I held up a sign that said John 3:16. It was an attention getter for those I was preaching to at a retirement home. My brothers in the men's ministry thought I was crazy. Of course, some of them still think I'm crazy. But when I spoke about the love of God mentioned in John 3:16, you know what happened? Two people gave their life to Jesus Christ that night. And that was no joke. That was God's grace. John 3:16 is a very familiar Bible verse to most of us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. These are the words of Jesus. And in context, he's talking to a Pharisee named Nicodemus who's asking questions about being born again. And Jesus is describing his mission to save the world through his sacrificial death. The word translated everlasting or eternal in some Bible translations is the Greek word aioneos, and it means without beginning or end, always has been, always will be, or never cease. The word translated life in John 3:16 is the Greek word zoe, and it means the absolute fullness of life, a real, genuine, active, blessed, and vigorous life devoted to God. When we read this verse, we often equate everlasting or eternal life with the length of time that we'll spend with the Lord in heaven. And that's absolutely true, that through our faith in Jesus Christ, we will spend eternity in heaven with God. However, we must consider what Jesus said about eternal life in his prayer to the Father in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we read that in John chapter 17 and verse 3. And this is eternal life. Same words. Ioneos Zoe. That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, who you sent. Whoa, Jesus. You just put a wrench in our whole preconception about eternal life. Jesus said eternal life is about knowing the Father. Knowing the Father and Jesus who the Father sent. So if we use the definition of eternal life that Jesus gave us in John chapter 17, verse 3, and we consider the definition of the words themselves, we get a very different perspective on this very familiar verse. For God, the Father, so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, who he sent, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but will never stop fully knowing the Father in a real and genuine and active and blessed and vigorous way. That is eternal life. In God's eyes, eternal life is more about knowing the Father. Knowing the Father now. Today, as we continue our Moving Forward series, the question for all of us is, how well do we know the Father? Are we moving forward in knowing the Father? All of us must answer this question. All of us are accountable for our relationship with the Father. But fathers, and I'm talking to you earthly fathers, you have a special accountability. The Apostle John writes in 1 John chapter 2, verse 13, I write to you, fathers, because you have known him. You have known him who was from the beginning. And to hammer his point home, he says the same thing in the next verse. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who was from the beginning. Now, in context, the term fathers is used here by John likely to mean mature believers. Could be men, could be women. But men, we can't hide from the fact that according to Scripture, fathers is the term used to describe those who know the Heavenly Father the best. There is a scriptural responsibility that is breathed on the word Father, that those who carry this title are setting the example for others to follow in their relationship with the Heavenly Father. So yes, every one of us is responsible for how well we know the Father and how much we experience eternal life right now. But earthly fathers, let me speak to you right now. You have a special responsibility to know the Father, not only on your own behalf, but on behalf of your entire family and generation after generation after generation. Some of you might be asking, so who is this Heavenly Father that we must get to know? Well, God is referred to as Father 13 times in the Old Testament and over 150 times in the New Testament. It is understood in Christian doctrine that God the Father is the first person of the triune God or the Trinity. We believe in the Church of God denomination that there is one God, eternally existing in three persons, namely the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we read about the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit in the Genesis creation story. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we read, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So, side note here for you ladies, you have dominion over creeps. You have dominion over creeps. Now, if I were to ask two of you to stand here on the platform with me, and I were to ask you, let's make something that looks like, acts like, feels like, and thinks like us, I'd likely say, in our images, or in our likenesses, because although we have common characteristics, we're three separate people. Yet in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, there is no separation between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We were made in their image, not images, and in their likeness, not likenesses. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one. And we read about this in several places in Scripture. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 reads, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Jesus says in John chapter 10, verse 30, "I and my Father are one." We also read about the way the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit interact with those who know God. Paul tells the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, that no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. We can't know Jesus unless we're prompted by the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 14, verse 6, a very familiar verse likely to many of you, Jesus says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." We just sang a beautiful song. But the truth is, we cannot run to the Father unless we first go through Jesus. Jesus is the means in which we know the Father. I want to show you two pictures. And I'm showing them today as a general depiction of what it means to know the Father. This is the first picture. In this picture, the believer is represented by the glass. And we can have a relationship with the Father, a relationship with the Son, a relationship with the Holy Spirit, essentially three separate relationships filling the same vessel. We can know the Father. We can know the Son. We can know the Holy Spirit. That's true. However, here's another however. I submit to you today, brothers, sisters, those watching online, that if we are looking at our relationship with a triune God this way, it's the wrong perspective. This is a picture of three pouring into one, not three in one pouring into one. Remember, God is one. One God, one image, one likeness in three persons. Three in one. That's why we can have a distinct and real relationship with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Our relationship with one is impacted by a relationship with the other. If we truly believe in the three in one, then tell me, how can I know the Father more than I know Jesus? If we truly believe in the three in one, then tell me, how can I know the Father more than I know the Holy Spirit? I make this point to simply say that we can't move forward in our relationship with the Father if we're not also moving forward in our relationship with Jesus and in our relationship with the Holy Spirit. And I'm not saying that you need to split your worship time between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit or worry about who you're addressing at what time. I'm saying that our relationship with the Father is connected with our relationship with Jesus and our relationship with the Holy Spirit. And let me talk to anyone who believes you can intimately know the Father without intimately knowing Jesus. Or without intimately knowing the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, those watching online, it's not possible with the three in one. And I think most of us recognize the tie between our relationship with Jesus and our relationship with the Father. But I believe many of us don't fully grasp the importance of our relationship with the Holy Spirit. In knowing the Father. So please don't log off your devices today believing that you can truly have a relationship with the Father without truly having a relationship with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was sent by the Father to reveal Jesus and point to the Father. Paul tells the Galatians in Galatians chapter 6, Verse 8, for he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Again, we see those same words, ioneos zoe. If we're consistent in the application of these words, it's fair to say that Paul's message to the Galatians here is this. The more you encounter the Holy Spirit, the more you'll know the Father. So we know the Father within the fullness of our relationship with the triune God. But how? How do we know the Father? Galatians chapter 4 tells us. Here the Apostle Paul is describing what it means to be an heir with Jesus Christ. And he says something that should sound very familiar to our rendition of John 3:16 in Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. And there are two things I want to point out about Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. Number one, we can see the Father sending. We can see the Son going. And we can see or hear the Holy Spirit crying out in these verses, all in respect to the believer's relationship with the Heavenly Father. And number two, Paul uses a phrase here that's important for us to understand. Abba, Father. Let's talk a little bit about Abba. Now, I know there's some people that teach that the term Abba means daddy. And many of us use the word Abba in times of intimacy with the Father. And it's true that the word Abba was a word used for Father at a time in which the New Testament was written, still used in Israel. But the biblical meaning of the term Abba is not best translated as daddy. Abba is more like the English word sir than daddy. It's a word born out of reverence for one's father. But actually, sir isn't the best definition of the word either. The true meaning of the word is best defined as Father, I will obey you. Father, I will obey you. Thus, there are two elements that must be present. Number one, intimacy. Only a child of the Father can use this term. And number two, obedience. It's only used in the context of obedience. The word Abba is used two other times in the New Testament, both of which include aspects of intimacy and obedience. In Mark chapter 14, verse 36, Jesus is having an intimate moment speaking to the Father in the Garden of Gethsemane just prior to his arrest and his crucifixion. And he yields to an obedient heart and tells his Abba Father, not my will, but your will be done. In Romans chapter 8, verse 15, Paul is speaking to the Romans about the intimacy of the spirit of sonship that they received. And in the context of the previous verses, he's also speaking to them about a heart of obedience that puts off their old sin nature, that puts off fear and cries, Abba, Father. If we use the term Abba as our measuring stick for knowing the Heavenly Father, we can determine how far we're moving forward in our terms of our relationship with the Father by our intimacy with Him and our obedience to Him. I submit that we all start at the same place. We don't come out of the womb knowing the Father. That wasn't even true for Jesus when He came in the flesh. But at some point, we've heard enough, we've seen enough, we've felt enough, we've experienced enough to reach the first level of intimacy. Well, I know God as your Father. If you're watching online today, unless you're being held against your will, at a minimum, you're at the Your Father stage. You might be at the Your Father stage for several reasons. One reason you might be at the Your Father stage is unfamiliarity. You're just simply learning about God. Maybe somebody invited you to watch online for the first time today. Maybe you're a young person now just learning that there is a God and that He loves you. Maybe you realize, well, there's something missing in your life, and you think that God might be the answer, but you're not sure. Maybe you feel something, a connection with the Father, but you're not quite sure what to do about it. If that's you, if you are unfamiliar with the Father, simply ask Him to reveal Himself to you. Open a Bible or open a Bible app and read the stories of Jesus in the New Testament, and give yourself an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to show you who the Father really is. Talk to someone who believes in the Father, who knows the Father, and ask them to share their story with you. The Scripture says that God is no respecter of persons. If the Father revealed Himself to one person, He will reveal Himself to you. Another reason you might be in the Your Father stage is disappointment. A few weeks ago, my 3-year-old granddaughter told her grandma, Nana, I don't know God. And when my wife asked why, my granddaughter replied, well, on Saturday I got in trouble. My mom scolded me. So I went to my room and I cried out to Jesus for help, but he never came. He never showed up. I must not know God because he didn't come when I asked him to come. Nana, why didn't he come when I called him? Why didn't he come when I called him? Maybe some of you are asking the same question about a situation or experience in your life, and you're at the your father stage because you've yet to receive the response you desire. But we must all remember that our circumstances do not define the Father's character. Scripture does. And the Scripture tells us that our Father is loving and kind and compassionate and giving and faithful and merciful and strong and just and good and forgiving and righteous and caring, ever present, a refuge and gracious and powerful, a healer, one who saves and one who makes all things new. That is who God the Father is. That's who wants to know you. That's who wants you to see through your disappointment and know that he did everything he possibly could to help you in your situation or your experience. And when the entirety of the situation or the experience is revealed to you, there will be no question that he's always had your best interests in mind. A third reason you might be at the your father stage is because, let me clear my throat for this one, you're living on pirated faith. You believe there's a God, but you've yet to establish a real, tangible relationship with your heavenly Father. You're living off the faith of your spouse or the faith of your parents. It's similar to using cable or Wi-Fi from your neighbor without paying for it yourself. You're receiving something. Maybe you're experiencing the favor of God in your household. Maybe your prayers are even being answered, but you truly don't know the Father. Somebody else knows the Father for you. If that's you today, this Father's Day is a great day to begin doing what Paul told the Philippians in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 12. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. We are all responsible for knowing the Father ourselves. We cannot pirate someone else's faith. Now, Scripture does not pinpoint the age or the situation where Jesus fully realized that God was his Father. Luke chapter 2 does, however, give us a no later than age. Here we read about the 12-year-old Jesus. He ditches Mary. He ditches Joseph for 3 days. He's in the temple asking questions, listening to the teachers. And when his parents find him, they're a little miffed at Jesus. And here's what Jesus tells them. This 12-year-old Jesus in Luke chapter 2, verse 49. Why'd you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business? So somewhere between the time of his birth and this discussion with his parents at the age of 12, Jesus moved forward in his relationship with the Father to the point where God was no longer just someone that Mary and Joseph spoke about. He realized God was his Father. He had reached the point where he could say, I know God as my Father. There's some people who would tell you that every person is a child of God. That's frankly not true. Every person is a creation of God, but only those who put their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior are called children of God. John chapter 1, verse 12 tells us, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right. It's the Greek word exousia. It's often translated authority. To those he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. When we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we exercise the authority to become a son or a daughter of God, and we exercise the authority paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. When we say, I know God as my Father, it's a phrase that's dripped in blood. If we're at this stage of intimacy with Abba Father, there's steps of obedience that go along with it. Number one, we're obedient to the faith. When Paul uses the phrase obedient to the faith in Romans chapter 1, verse 5, he means we don't only just believe that Jesus is our Savior, we believe what we read in the scriptures. We believe what Jesus said. We believe what Jesus did, and we apply it to our own lives. And number two, we are obedient to the commandments. Jesus says in John chapter 15, verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. The commandments are simple. Love God. Love others. In loving God, we abstain from sin and place a priority on our relationship with God. In loving others, we forgive. We walk in humility. We serve. We give. These are the types of things we do if we claim the right to call God my Father. Something else happens when we put our faith in Jesus Christ. Yes, we know God as my Father, but we also know God as our Father. As part of the body of Christ, we all share the same Father. Jesus describes in John chapters 14 to 17 that the Holy Spirit is in the believer. Jesus is in the believer. The Father is in the believer. The three in one resides in every believer. And not only are we connected to the triune God, but we're connected with each other through the triune God. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. We are a spiritual family. And Jesus recognized the importance of this connection when he taught the disciples how to pray in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 9. And he didn't say, okay, pray this way. My Father in heaven. No, he said, pray this way. Our Father in heaven. He recognized the power of this prayer was in its application in a spiritual family setting. If we're at this stage of intimacy with Abba Father, there are also steps of obedience that go along with it. Number one, we're obedient to the unity of the Spirit. Paul urges the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3 to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. This means that those of us who stand beside our brothers and our sisters in Christ and pray, our Father, do so with an unbreakable bond for each other. That's not concerned with the color of each other's skin or social status or titles or opinions. We're not unified. We're not unified because we agree with each other. We're unified because God is our Father, and we are all one in him and with him. And number two, we're obedient to the commission. When Jesus tells the disciples in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. This is a commission to the body of Christ, or those who would say, I know God as our Father. This commission requires everyone in the body of Christ to do their part. If we desire to be obedient to Abba Father, we must do our part and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ and making disciples. In closing, let me say that there's another level. There's another stage that we should all be aspiring to reach in knowing the Father. In his final words to the Father in the prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus says this in John chapter 17 and verse 25. Father, I've revealed them. I've revealed you to them and will continue to do so. Then your love for me will be in them and I will be in them. We know we've arrived when we can say, I have revealed the Father and will continue to do so. Paul says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. In other words, Jesus was full of himself, full of the Son. He was full of the Father. He was full of the Holy Spirit. In Christ, we have been given the same opportunity to carry the fullness of God in us. And the man Jesus wasn't full of the Godhead until he was full of the Holy Spirit when he was baptized. The same is true for us. We must be filled with the Holy Spirit to carry the fullness of God. And when we do so, we will reveal the Father. I'm going to say something that might sound hard to believe in, so I'll add verily, verily in front of it to make it more believable. Verily, verily. If we carry the fullness of the Godhead, then we're positioned. We're positioned to speak the same words that Jesus spoke to Philip in John chapter 14 and verse 9. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. In this stage, we're not claiming to be the Father. Well, neither was Jesus. We're saying we can be so full of the Father, so full of the Son, so full of the Holy Spirit that they're spilling out for everyone to see. Others can see on the outside what is overflowing from the inside. That should be our goal this Father's Day. We want to reveal the Father. There might be some of you that are watching today that say, you know, Pastor Herb, I think I'm at that I know God as your Father stage, but I want to move into the I know God as my Father or our Father stage. I want to receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Let me pray with you right now. Father, by their own admission, by those who desire to have this relationship with you, to know you as my Father, to know you as our Father, and to move in revealing who you are to a lost and hurting world. I stand with them, Lord God. I pray for them, Lord God. And I ask, Lord God, that they would just receive you right now. Receive the forgiveness of the Father right now. Receive the forgiveness of the Father and enter the kingdom of God. If you pray today and received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, please text the word forgive to the number on the screen. We'll send you some digital resources to help you in your decision to be a follower of Jesus Christ and to know the Father. Again, happy Father's Day to all of our fathers. Enjoy your eternal life today.